Hello and welcome to the Business Standard Morning Show. I'm Vinu Sandhu. Let's take a look at the stories for the day. India's GDP grew by 8.4% in the second quarter of this financial year. Boosted by rising vaccination numbers, Asia's third largest economy is seeing a rebound from a historic economic contraction last year. But is it all good news? Let's look at what the Q2 numbers mean for India's economic recovery and the risks ahead.
Data released by the government yesterday showed that India's gross domestic product expanded 8.4% from a year ago in the second quarter ended September, with the economic recovery gaining ground as most states removed lockdown restrictions from July. This was slower than the record 20.1% growth witnessed in the previous quarter, which came on a low base. Nevertheless, this marks a fourth straight quarter of GDP growth. The growth in the second quarter was led by an uptick in consumer spending as well as government expenditure. But things are not as hunky-dory as they seem. To know the actual state of the economy, we must shift our focus from growth rate to absolute levels of real GDP. Despite growing by 8.4% year-on-year in the July to September period, the absolute GDP of India stood at Rs. 35.73 lakh crore for the quarter. This is only slightly more than the Rs. 35.61 lakh crore seen in the corresponding quarter 2 years ago. After last fiscal's contraction of 7.3%, the RBI expects the GDP to grow by 9.5% in FY22, once again giving India the tag of the world's fastest growing major economy. Some high-frequency indicators show that India's recovery is gaining momentum. Merchandise exports jumped 42% in October to $35.5 billion, while bank credit growth accelerated to 6.8%. Industrial production too expanded 3.1% in September. The spread of the Omicron variant of the coronavirus and inflation remain one of the biggest risks in the near term. The variant has prompted several countries to impose travel curbs. Indian companies are facing high pressure on margins as commodity prices increase their input costs. FMCG companies like ITC, Hindustan Unilever, and Parle Products have hiked prices across categories. Further, domestic two-wheeler sales fell 29% in the first 7 months of this fiscal to a 7-year low. Hero MotoCorp, Bajaj Auto, TVS, and Royal Enfield have also been raising prices to offset input cost pressures. The sales of passenger vehicles too fell 27% in October. We spoke to Madan Sabnavis, chief economist at CARE Ratings, to make sense of the GDP numbers.
The GDP estimate for the second quarter of this year at 8.4% is more or less in line with what we had expected. However, we will not be changing the forecast for the year, because while there are signs that things are taking off, especially in the services sector, one is not quite sure about the progress of the third wave of COVID and whether it will lead to restrictions and some kind of lockdown, especially in the services sector. But if you look at these numbers and look at the absolute number of GDP for the second quarter, it does have the advantage of coming over a low base. But however, if we compare it with Q2 of 1920, which was a pre-COVID era, it does look like that we are just marginally higher. So quite clearly, I think Q3 and Q4 would be the deciding factors to really show us that the economy has come out of the rut. And what were indications we had in the months of October and November, that was during the festival season, did show that consumption was up, especially of manufactured goods. And today, if we add to it the fact that services have been opened up quite rapidly, there is hope that things will look much better. On the capital formation side, we have seen it's once again gone into the 28 region, 28.4%. But this, I think, is more on account of what the government has been doing, because if you juxtapose the fiscal numbers, we've seen that the government's capital expenditure has been very much on target. And that has been responsible for this higher capital formation numbers, which we have seen in the economy for this quarter. But if you look at all the sectors, yes, it's been quite impressive. I think almost all the segments have recorded good growth rates, aided by the base effect. But I think what's significant is the fact that we have a good foundation on which there can be more accelerated growth in the coming quarters, provided, of course, we don't again encounter any further lockdowns.
It is good news that India's absolute GDP surpassed pre-pandemic levels, but consumer spending has still not caught up to FY20 levels, thus making the ripple effects of the pandemic palpable in the economy.
After encouraging GDP numbers, there's another piece of good news for the country. Social media giant Twitter has followed in the footsteps of Google and Microsoft to place an Indian origin techie at the helm. Parag Agarwal, who until Sunday was the chief technology officer, has succeeded co-founder Jack Dorsey as the CEO of Twitter. Does Agarwal's elevation signify Twitter's coming of age, just as in the case of Microsoft when Nadella took over? Watch this report.
Twitter has finally decided to transfer its reins from founders to professionals. India-born Parag Agrawal has succeeded co-founder Jack Dorsey as the CEO of the social media giant. So will a more diversified board, with an Indian at the helm of affairs, help the company at a time when it is aiming to double its revenue by 2023 and reinvent its image amid several allegations in recent times? In a statement, Dorsey said the company was ready to move on from its founders. The board of directors of Twitter unanimously selected Agrawal as CEO and a member of the board. This wasn't Dorsey's first exit from the company. After co-founding the social media giant in 2006, Dorsey had been forced out in 2008, but he returned as CEO in 2015 after Dick Costello stepped down. In 2020, Dorsey was accused of paying little attention to Twitter. Agrawal, meanwhile, had joined Twitter in 2011 with a focus on ad products. He became the first recipient of the company's Distinguished Engineer title, according to several media reports. After being appointed as the Chief Technology Officer at Twitter in 2017, Agrawal encouraged Dorsey to allow Twitter to explore decentralization and other related technologies. A 2005 Computer Science and Engineering alumnus of IIT Bombay, 37-year-old Agrawal is the youngest CEO leading a Standard & Poor's 500 company. Agrawal, a known face in Silicon Valley, has a long and tough road ahead. By the end of 2023, the company wants to have 315 million monetizable daily active users. It also wants to double its revenue by then. Apart from meeting the financial targets, Twitter will also have to do a balancing act when it comes to sensitive issues. In October this year, Twitter admitted that its algorithm was giving more space to right-wing politicians than left-leaning ones. And in September last year, some Twitter users had pointed out that the platform's photo previews favored white faces to black. They posted photos of a black person's face and a white person's face side by side to show that Twitter's photo previews showed white faces more often. The social media giant had to apologize for this goof up too. Agrawal, who was the chief technology officer then, had taken stock of the situation and admitted that the model needed continuous improvement. Agrawal is also tasked with addressing one of the company's biggest challenges in recent times, content moderation. Around this time last year, Twitter had labeled some tweets from former US President Donald Trump as misleading and violent. And earlier this year, the Indian government and Twitter were locked in a bitter standoff. First, it was about Twitter choosing not to ban tweets and accounts related to the farmers' protest, despite the Indian government telling it to do so. Later, the Indian government had accused Twitter of not complying with its new rules for social media intermediaries and even threatened legal action against its India executives. The situation had cooled down only after Twitter appointed an executive based out of India. Let us go to Business Standard's Neha Alawadi to understand more about Jack Dorsey's exit and the challenges ahead for the new Twitter CEO.
One issue that has been a constant, constant issue with most analysts and shareholders who've been tracking the company is on monetization. Twitter has, it's kind of experimented with a bunch of products. They had a great product in Periscope, but that didn't take off, for example. Now they've probably hit a sweet spot with stuff like Spaces, and they've been trying a few new monetization strategies. They have a tip jar, for example, and ticketed spaces is something that they're considering and testing out. So these are some of the things that they've done during the year, but there's no solid monetization strategy that has convinced investors, very solidly in the last few years. So that is one thing. And on the other front, Twitter does have, it faces similar issues as some of its competitors on, how it moderates content and hate speech, etc. But before we get into that, I think it's also important to understand that there was some amount of activist shareholder pressure when Elliot came on board last year. And one of the things that Elliot pointed out was Jack Dorsey not being able to give enough attention to Twitter because he's also involved with Square, which is the other company that he heads. So, and that has been, again, an issue that has come up time and again. More specific issue that Twitter has is pressure from a lot of conservative right-wing groups in India and in other jurisdictions. And not just that, even from, the left or whatever. Like, essentially, Twitter is seen as a more political platform. A lot of political activity happens on Twitter. It does not have the same kind of user base that, say, a Facebook or a YouTube commands, but it is a more active space for conversation. So one of the issues that has been problematic is how the way it banned the previous US president, and that is something that has been of concern to Indian parliamentarians as well, and rightfully so probably, because their issue is how can you just ban a person for having a political view? If the platform is going to decide, then that is a kind of threat that every politician across the world faces.
So does having an Indian at the helm of affairs augur well for Twitter's fortunes in India? It's third largest market with 17.5 million users as of February this year. We will have to wait and see if Parag Agrawal can turn things around for the social media company.
We'll have to wait and see how Agrawal takes forward Twitter's Blue Sky project, decentralized social media protocol, and NFT-based profile pictures. For now, let's take a look at the markets. Frontline indices fell nearly 4% in November, clocking the biggest monthly fall since March 2020. Renewed COVID scare, unfavorable risk reward, and a possible change in interest rate scenarios made Indian equities less attractive during the month. However, analysts expect sectoral rotation to take place here on and bet on defensive plays to support the markets. Our next report delves into one such sector and the stocks that are likely to shine.
The BSE Sensex and the Nifty 50 ended the month of November on a weak footing as fears that the new Omicron COVID-19 variant could potentially evade vaccines rattled investor confidence. On Tuesday, the benchmarks ended over 0.25% down, resulting in a monthly fall of around 4%. The BSE benchmark index shed over 2,200 points or 3.7% during the month, while the 50-packed Nifty index erased around 690 points to post their biggest monthly fall since March 2020. Going forward, Naveen Kulkarni, who is the Chief Investment Officer at Axis Securities, believes news related to Omicron, oil prices and dollar index movement will keep the markets volatile in the near term. As the FIIs have been net sellers in November, the support of domestic institutional investors, he says, will be critical to sustain market at the current levels. He advises investors to choose stocks of companies with high earnings visibility and rotate funds between sectors that will likely deliver superior returns. One such sector which investors can bet on to ride the current defensive market mood is information technology. Despite a weak market closing yesterday, the Nifty IT index ended over 0.5% higher, with individual stocks such as LTTS and Coforge ending with gains of up to 1.5%. Over the past 6 months, the Nifty IT index has advanced 29% on the NSE as against a 10% surge in the Nifty 50 index. Accelerated revenue in Q2, broad-based demand and the healthy deal pipeline are some of the reasons for this outperformance, say analysts at MK Global Financial Services. Although seasonal factors such as lower working days and furloughs will weigh on the Q3 sequential growth trajectory, they expect the revenue momentum to continue throughout FY2022. So which stocks should you add to your portfolio for double-digit returns? Let us go to Business Standard's Avdhoot Bakkar for a quick tech check.
The Nifty IT index is trading sideways in a broad range of 37,000 to 34,000 levels in September. And yesterday it showed a smart recovery around the lower band and can expect a rally back to 37,000 levels. For IT stocks, TCS, Tech Mahindra and L&T Technologies, which are fairly placed at current levels, may see a positive rally in their uncharted territories. TCS may see a jump of 8%, whereas Tech Mahindra and L&T Technologies may explore new levels. TCS could see a rally towards 1750 and L&T Technologies may run in the direction of 5800-5850 levels.
Fundamentally, analysts at MK Global expect Infosys, TechM, HCL Tech and Mphasis to rally up to 25% over the short to medium term. Coming in today's trades, global cues and developments around the new virus variant will guide the indices on Wednesday. Back home, reaction to Q2 GDP data and primary market activity will support the sentiment. The three-day public issue of Star Health Insurance will enter its second day today. The 7,249 crore rupees IPO has been subscribed less than 15% so far and will close tomorrow. That apart, the public offer of Tega Industries will also open for subscription today. The mill liner producers company aims to raise 619 crore rupees fixed and has fixed a price band of 443 to 453 rupees per share.
The market may be in a defensive mood currently, but IPOs are the flavor of the season. The IPOs of Paytm and Nykaa kept people glued to their screens recently. Their listings in the primary market made a lot of news due to Paytm's poor showing and Nykaa's unexpected success. But have you ever wondered what is primary market and how is it different from the secondary market? Let's find out.
The primary market provides companies a platform to float their initial public offerings or IPOs and raise capital. The involvement of companies ends with the primary market. And in the secondary market, the shares allotted in the primary market are traded. Just think of a situation where there was no secondary market and people had to track down the shareholders to buy or sell a stock. So, the secondary market works as a platform which brings together all the sellers and buyers of stocks. Primary market refers to a marketplace where shares or securities are first offered by the issuer or company to the general public. It is also known as the IPO market. Companies tap the primary market to list at the bourses and raise funds. This fund can be used to pay the company's debt obligation, expand capacity, or provide an exit to some of the existing stakeholders. A company has to meet a set of financial regulatory criteria before making a debut in the primary market. Secondary market refers to the open stock market, a place where investors can buy and sell shares at prevailing prices. Also, shares of companies that are issued through the primary market are then available for buying and selling in the secondary market once the listing process is completed. For example, a company, let us call it ABC, wants their share to be listed on the stock exchanges. So it will float an IPO in the primary market. Over there, after the IPO is closed, shares will be allotted to successful bidders. And after the share allotment, these stocks will be listed and available for trading in the secondary market. So, investors can now buy and sell shares anytime during market hours. Well, the fact is, both these markets are not comparable as they play a diverse role. Primary market is the gateway for companies desirous to list their shares in the secondary market. And in the secondary markets like Bombay Stock Exchange or New York Stock Exchange, investors trade in previously issued securities.
And that's all we have for you today. We'll be back tomorrow morning with more news and analysis. Stay tuned and thank you for watching.
If you like this video, share it and subscribe to Business Standard. For more news, views and insights, log on to www.business-standard.com. Do also follow us on YouTube, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, Telegram and LinkedIn.